This is the Pete and Sebastian Show with Pete Corielli and Sebastian Maniscalco.
From Boston. And you know I wanted to address Petey's steak knife stabby banana game, but Drunk Luke stole the show. By the way, Petey, you can cut a banana with a spoon and feed it just as easy to your daughter, and you don't have to worry about her sneezing and poking an eye out. But that's besides the point. Lou, you were too high for the streets, kid. It was hilarious and uncomfortable. Get your shit together, kid. Later.
You better shape up, 'cause I need a plan. But my heart is set on you.
All right, so last week you guys told me to let the songs play longer. So Lou goes with Grease.
Can you explain to him, Sebastian?
I don't know, Lou.
Well, I think he said something, you better shape up, and that's the first words that I hit.
Oh, my. What are we doing? Play on words to start every show now, Lou? What just happened to some fantastic rock and roll that no one's heard before, a cover or something? I mean, you literally just played Olivia Newton-John.
Yeah, I like it.
Tell me about it, Stan.
Well, here we are, Pete and Sebastian Show. We're back. I'm doing it from the Kevin Can Wait studio. Sebastian is live in New York City at Sirius XM. Lou's behind the glass, and I think we all chose these places to do it this time, so we're all sober. We're nice and sober this week. What's up, Sebastian?
Lou and I are face-to-face. He's drinking a Diet Pepsi, and everybody's sober, although I think last show, if I do say so myself, was one of our best since we started this thing, and maybe it takes a little booze to get this thing in gear.
That was a lot of fun. I had a ball. Absolutely. I interrupt a lot when I get a little tipsy. So, is this the last one before Christmas? What are we thinking?
I think, Lou, did you say you're gone next week?
I can do it whenever you guys can.
I will, we could do it regular Tuesday and then shut it down for the year. Right?
All right.
Or wait. Pete, you're going to go back to Fredonia on Tuesday?
Yeah, I think I'm going back Tuesday.
Will you have, your machine?
I think I'm going to drive, so I'll be able to bring the machine.
Are you chewing gum?
I was. I'll put it back. I'm sorry.
Last week it's liquor, this week it's gum. I mean, come on.
I'm sorry. No, it's unprofessional. I'll put it back where it goes, in between my gum and my cheek. What's going on, man? What are you doing in New York City?
I am here doing some business. I went to go see Pacelli last night, Andrea, right? So about, I'd say, a month and a half, 2 months back, I get an Instagram direct message from this doctor who's claiming he's Pacelli's doctor. And he said that he shared my Bocelli bit. I have a bit that I do about Andrea Bocelli, you know, with the white horse, you know, from Tuscany.
Yeah. Right.
And apparently he shared that with Bocelli, and he said that Bocelli would like for me to come to the show. So I'm like, okay, but I was really skeptical. I was not trusting of this message, so I had Georgie and Judy kind of look into it and vet this guy out. So they're going back and forth. The guy checks out, but I'm still kind of weary about meeting this guy because he wants to meet for dinner first and then go to the show.
But you not dinner with Bocelli, just the
Well,
show.
At first it's dinner with Bocelli. Then it's dinner.
Holy
then
shit.
It's dinner. No Bocelli and Steven Van Zandt from Sopranos, right?
That's a good alt.
So yeah. So it was like, all right, what's going on here? Who's going to be at?
By the way,
dinner?
Steven Van Zandt from the Bruce Springsteen band. That's the bigger credit. But continue.
I don't know. Is it Sopranos? Sopranos was arguably one of the most popular shows on TV. Do you think Bruce Springsteen E Street Band beats out Soprano?
By a million. Well, I don't even know what we're having this conversation. The lead guitarist for one of the greatest rock icons in the history of the planet over some Guido soap opera? I mean, I love that show too. Don't get me wrong, but I mean, that's old news.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
When I came in to open up one morning, dear, you were with your head half in the toilet. Your hair was in the toilet water. Disgusting.
I told you I had the flu.
I said my piece, Chrissy.
So the dinner set at Remy Restaurant. I go there last night, and I'm running late, so I tell Georgie to call this guy and let them know that I'm not going to be there on time. She's getting his voicemail. His voicemail's full. You ever run across people like this where the voicemail's full? Is your voicemail ever full?
No, mine's never full. One time Brewers was full. When I finally got through, I was like, what, you win an Oscar last night? But let me ask you this. If Bocelli was still scheduled for the dinner, would you have been running late?
There's nothing I could have done to get there. I got off an airplane and went right to the dinner.
Oh, okay. So all right, it was an airplane situation.
Yeah. So, and this guy's a doctor, and his voicemail's full.
So now you're thinking, am I going to a rendezvous where there's going to be no one there? What's going on? Oh. I'm flying blind.
Yeah, I think I'm going to like a Joe Pesci hit in Goodfellas where they shut the door and I go, oh, no, and boom, right to the back of the head.
And we couldn't do nothing about it.
Right?
Oh, yeah. By the way, does this doctor know that, like, this is like you'd almost rather have involuntary root canal? You're doing the dinner just to meet Pacelli. This is like a dangling carrot. It's like, who? I would not want to eat with you if I was saying, you break bread with me when we're done. I shall introduce you to Kevin James. Fuck it. Yeah, that's like, who would enjoy that meal? Doesn't he know that? Anyway.
He's seen my show.
He's a nice man.
He's orchestrating his dinner, but I don't know this guy from nothing. I'm going in blind, like you said. Right. So I go to the restaurant. I check in at the front desk there, and no reservation for him. And I look at the restaurant. It's a private Christmas party going on. I go, the fuck? I said, you got a restaurant in the back? He goes, yeah, we do. But hold on, let me make a phone call. She makes a phone call. She hangs up the phone. She's like, that reservation is at our other restaurant, our sister restaurant a couple blocks up. That's where they are. So I'm thinking to myself, you switched the restaurant and you didn't bother letting us know that you did that? Right then, I'm like, fuck it, I ain't going. I ain't going to see these people. If this is the way they're handling it, I don't like them.
Right.
But then the other side of my brain's like, what if Bocelli's there? What's the Bocelli is the whole thing here, right?
Of course. That's the dangling carrot. You came this far. What's a few more blocks?
So I walk down and I see this guy through the window because he looks at me. I look at him. It was one of the things. He stood up from his chair, greeted me at the front, and I go, guy, no, you're not picking up the phone? Why? I go, I was at Remy. Oh, no, we changed it. He blows right over it. Right. We go to the table. There's 20 people at the table.
Oh.
And they're like, Sebastian, we love your comedy. I go, I was fished. I just got catfished.
Oh, boy.
So I'm like upset. I'm upset. And I'm like, people are going, oh, we love your bit about the grandma in the basement with lasagna. I go, lasagna, I don't want to be here right now.
Oh, man.
So I look at the head of the table, Van Zandt.
That's you.
All right. I'm in the right spot. Right?
Yeah, yes.
I didn't get fished. I thought it was going to be a small, intimate dinner. I had no idea 20 people deep were going to be there. But I get sat at the table with Van Zandt, his wife, and there's some pasta in front of me. Now, granted, I'm an hour late, and I'm starving. I didn't have anything to eat all day long. By the way, me and Lou just made eye contact, and it got weird.
I did not.
I'm telling you, man. That's why we don't do it face to face. This is a win right now, no matter what. You got to be in New York for business anyway, and now you're having dinner with the lead guitarist for Bruce's band and, quite frankly, a great character in Sopranos. This is a nice dinner.
This is a nice dinner. So I sit down. There's a bowl of pasta in front of me. I start eating the pasta. I wolf it down like it's not even there. It was one of those bowls where it's not enough for an entree. It's like an appetizer portion. I wolf it down, and now I'm scanning. You ever scan the table and start seeing what other food is available, like leftovers, like appetizer-wise?
Yeah.
Saw some calamari. I'm like, all right, I'm not going to go for the calamari because there's probably another course coming out. So I finish it, and the doctor goes, cappuccino? Espresso? Look, cappuccino, it's over? I'm ready for the meat. Isn't the meat coming out? So we're wrapping it up already. And I understood it, like, you know, he probably, you know, ordered some appetizers and they had some pizza and pasta, but I was starving.
No. You know I'm coming. You know, I'll say it for you. You're at a certain level now. It's a big deal. I'm coming. You have all these people announcing it. You sit me down to Van Zandt. Nobody thinks to order me a fucking pizza. Sebastian's come. Let's get him a margarita. Pizza, just so he has a little something to nibble on before Bichelle.
In all fairness, I think they offered me a pizza, but I thought, like, nah, I don't want to have pizza. I'd rather have the main dish or whatever's coming. So I balked on the pizza. Anyway, guy picks up the bill, and we're off to the concert.
Where's the concert?
Madison Square Garden.
Whoa, Bocelli.
So we take a car ride over there, and these are nice people. I mean, they're Italians, a lot of them from Brooklyn. The doctor's son there, he's also a doctor. Very, very nice people, and very, very sweet that they invited me to this. So this is something, again, out of my wheelhouse. This is something maybe you would do, Pete. This is not something that I would be meeting strangers going to a concert. This is really out of my wheelhouse, but I'm glad I'm involved because there's stories. I'm in it for the story at this point.
Yeah.
So this doctor's a type of doctor. He don't wait for nobody. Like, he walks ahead of you. Like one of these guys that gets out of the car and he's in the building and his wife's still tripping off the curb. You know, like one of these guys. Like that just goes. And the wife and the son and everybody. This guy would be checked in. This is how bad it is. He was checking us in with the tickets, and like his wife and like the rest of his party is like they're getting stopped at the ticket gate because that guy, the doctor, was so far in the building already. He had to come back and get his people.
Yeah, it's all right. I'm with you.
We go into this like a lounge area, have a couple of drinks, and then we go to the seats. Now, mind you, this doctor, I guess, treated Bocelli's father and, extended his life probably a good 5 years. So Bocelli's, indebted to him.
Gotcha.
We go to the seats. Fourth row, I could smell Bocelli's cologne.
Makes you wonder what the people in the first three rows did to the old man. I'm sorry, I saved your father's life. Who the fuck's in front of me right now? I mean, I thought he was going to sit you on Bocelli's blind lap. I mean, Jesus.
So I'm like, oh, these are to save your life seats.
Oh, nice.
So Bocelli does 15, 20 minutes, and it's intermission because we got there a little late. Then we had a drink, so we only saw about 20 minutes. And now we're going to go back and meet him during intermission. I've never seen anything like this. This guy's doing a meet and greet in between the show. So we go back. And his wife is back there kind of orchestrating everything. It's a small meet and greet. I'd say there's about 25, 30 people in the room. There's two photographers. Bocelli comes back. And people are taking photos with Bocelli. I meet the wife. I meet Bocelli. There's no indication whatsoever that Bocelli or the the wife know I'm the guy that does the Bocelli bit. Like, I didn't hear from the wife, oh my God, you're the thing with the stallion and the
yeah.
None of that. Take the photo. Bocelli's whisked out of the room. It was, you know, he was there and then he was gone. And I'm thinking to myself, do they even know? Like, I was wondering, do they know? Or did this guy just use this to get me? I don't know what the hell was going on. But whatever it was, I was just happy to be in the presence of the man right. himself. No horse, now, but just the man himself.
Now, I don't want to interrupt. Is that where it ended with Bocelli? Did we see him again?
No, Bocelli's gone. And the next time we see him is on stage singing again.
Well, I got a problem with this, man.
Okay, go ahead.
We go from maybe eating dinner with Bocelli to Bocelli not even acknowledging I'm the guy who did the bit that he liked. Well, what was the exact exchange between you, the wife, and Bocelli? You walk up. Is the doctor doing the intros?
Yeah. This is Sebastian. Hi. Yeah, I met the wife. Hi, how are you? And Bocelli, you know, hey, how are you? I mean, like, Bocelli, you know, he's blind. He's not going to know who I am unless somebody had whispered in there, it's a guy that does the bit. And so nobody said that. So I don't know. I don't know if they even knew I have a bit about Bocelli riding on a white horse outside Tuscany. I have no clue. But based on the interaction I had with them, there was no indication that they knew I even did comedy, let alone a bit about Bocelli.
Or are you tempted to say, hey, I heard you liked my bit. I did a bit about you coming in on a horse.
I don't know. It was one of those things where I didn't like... I just was in the wings, in the background type of thing, you know, like speak if spoken to type of deal. You know, I didn't want to, you know, go, hey, I'm the comedian that does the bit on the horse. Where do I sit? You know, like, well, I wasn't going to do that.
I know, but I don't know. At this point, after everything you've been through, cold calamari and changing restaurants, I'm getting some out of this. Andre, I'm the guy. I'm the guy. Oh, don't you recognize the voice? Hear the voice. I mean, shit. Wow.
I don't know, but I didn't say nothing. I just shut my mouth. I took the photo. Hopefully, I'll get a copy of the photo. And then we go back to our seats, and we watch the second half of the concert. Now, you know, he's got a ballerina that comes out. He's got a, you know, girl and guy ballerina team. He's got a couple guest stars that come out and sing. The nice thing about it, and I'm thinking if a comedian could get away with this, he does a few songs. You know, he stands there and he sings.
Yeah.
And then they take him back, and then, like, another singer comes out, and she does a few songs, and then they bring him back up again. Couple songs, another guest singer. This guy's got it made. I'm thinking, comedians get away with just coming out 20 minutes, going in the back for 5 or 10, taking a rest, and have another comedian come out, and then come back out again, do another 20, and then rest a little bit. No.
Well, that's like you host the show. It's like if you hosted your own show, kind
of. Well, I mean, it'd be like you're doing the bulk of the show.
Yeah.
But in between, you have a guy come out and do 5 to 7 minutes as you go back and maybe, I don't know, wash your face off a little bit.
Yeah, that'd be nice, right? You do one last big bit before the intermission and go, hey, let that settle. You guys let that settle. I'll see you in 10. Yeah. We're doing good. We're having a good time. That would be nice.
Yeah, and I could introduce a special guest. Let's say I'm doing a show, and I said, you know what? Pete's in town. Pete, get out of here. Do some time. And then you go up. I leave and I go, another fucker, Brett Ernst just stopped by. Get out of here, Brett. You do some time. I don't know. It felt like that. That's the vibe at his concert. And then also I'm looking around. This guy's got a 60-piece band. And then he's got a choir. This guy's got about 100 people on stage with him. And I'm thinking to myself, what the fuck are they making?
Bocelli going home with like $75 when it's all done?
Yeah. I'm looking, he's got a big IMAX screen. He's got a whole stage. Of course, I'm looking at the top. I go, that's not Madison Square Garden lighting. That's his lighting. He brought that shit in. So, yeah, this guy's got it lot of expenses here. So we watched the end of the concert. Everybody's waiting for that song. You know, the Lou, you got that Partito, I think it's. Oh yeah, this thing came on, and the whole crowd. And by the way, I was talking to some of the security guards there at intermission, and I go, guys, this looks like church. You know, like everybody's got their hands on their lap. They're dressed nice. You go, they didn't know what to do. They told me. They're like, we don't know what to do. We're used to putting guys in headlocks, taking them out back, people smoking pot. There's getting fights. There's like,
I go, yeah, look around.
I mean, no one's under 48 years old here, you know?
Absolutely, man. The Garden has never had so much class in it.
Oh, God. So this song comes on that's on right now, right? I'm looking in the front row. There's a guy about 85 years old with a cane, right? He looks like, you know, they might have brought him out of his a hospice for this concert. And he's sitting there, and this song comes on, and this guy stood up straight. I mean, he looked like he literally... like God came down and anointed him, and the guy floated out of his chair, and I think actually took a step. I think Pacelli made this guy walk. That's how good this song is.
It sounds like it must have been on the old man's bucket list if he's standing up front.
Oh, yeah. It must have been on his bucket list, but then I'm going, you know, back to your point. What did he do for Bocelli's father?
Oh, man.
So at the end of the night, the concert's over. He does New York, New York. And then he does one final song that I didn't recognize, and then show's over. We're making our way outside. Now, at the end of the night, I didn't want to bother nobody. I just wanted to go back to my hotel and get an Uber or whatever. But these people are like, nah, come on, we'll take you. So we went in the car, had a great time with these guys. So this is like three guys and their wives. Really sweet people. Type of guy, the Brooklyn guys, and they talk. Like, you get around like New Yorkers, especially Italians. And I'm not too familiar with this because it wasn't quite this way in Chicago, but like New Yorkers, especially the Italians, they talk over one another. Like, you don't even know what to fucking listen to. There's six conversations going on in the car at once.
Yeah.
And I go, guys, you following any of this? Everybody's talking at once, you know, but like somehow it made sense. And the guy in the front who had a big personality, really cool guy, he was in the front, but he was talking so passionately. You ever talk to somebody who's in the front seat, but they really want to be in the back seat with everybody else?
Oh, yeah.
This guy was leaning. Half of his torso was in the back seat of this SUV. Like, his head was in my lap. That's how far whipping back this guy was. I go, this guy, unbelievable.
That's cool. He's in it, man.
Oh, is he in it? He didn't want to be in the front seat. He actually, if there was a seat that faced us that was on the council, he'd sit there and just hold court. That's how involved this guy wanted to be in the conversation. But really, really cool guy. They dropped me off, had a great time. But again, I will never know whether or not Bocelli even knows that I do a bit about him.
Andrea Bocelli was performing in Tuscany. Anybody know who this is? Okay, so we go. It's beautiful. I mean, it was outside, 8,000 people in the middle of Tuscany, rolling hills all around us. We sit down, the guy comes out, gives us 2 hours, singing his life out, ends the concert. Me and my wife start to leave. We walk down a gravel road. We're holding hands. Everybody's exiting, just talking about the show. That's what you do. You go see a show, and you talk about it on the way out. You're going to do it tonight. You're going to go, hey, I'm all right. You want to get some ice cream or something? And so me and my wife, holding hands, walking down the gravel road. Now, coming towards us is a guy telling people to get the hell out of the way. Behind them is Bocelli on a white horse. The guy's blind. There's no safety code. No city ordinance in Italy. The guy's blind, riding a horse through 8,000 people. Nobody said shit. Could you imagine tonight if I had a white stallion out front and took it down Broadway? I get pulled over at the light. What the fuck are you doing? Nah, I saw Buccelli do it in Tuscany.
The Pete and Sebastian Show.
You guys have been great.
I got to see that photo because so when he is he, you know, when you're blind like that, does he just kind of look straight ahead? Did you shake his hand even?
I shook his hand and, you know, I didn't look at him, but, you know, he closed, his eyes are closed.
Yeah.
Doesn't wear sunglasses, although he could get away with wearing sunglasses. By the way, I mean, blind guys can get away with the sunglass look indoors. I think it actually really, really works. I've always wanted to wear sunglasses indoors. I just don't have the excuse to do it.
Yeah, I know. I'm the same thing, man. I got almost met a rock and roll guy this weekend myself.
Who's that?
I got so I was playing, is a gig you did. This past Saturday, I was doing a corporate gig at the Wynn in Vegas. So I get there, I just got to do 40 minutes. It's going to be like in front of 700 people. The company, the guy saw me on Showtime, so he's a fan. So it wasn't like, you know, prove yourself. But the guy who books it, you know, is he books all the corporate stuff, Doug.
Okay, yeah, okay, now I know it is.
So anyway, it's like maybe 2 hours before the show. They go down there and Doug showed me around. And he goes, by the way, it's a surprise, but after you, the band Foreigner is going to play.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a surprise to all them. So, you know, I mean, dude, I know you're not that familiar with Foreigner.
No, I work with them. At one of these gigs.
I know you did. That's why I'm bringing this back up. Oh, okay, but like, okay. But even I remember even then when you were doing, you're like, you go, I didn't realize how many hits they had. I told Lou, did you put something together for us to let the listeners know what we're talking about with Foreigner?
Yeah, tell me when to stop because it's long because there's so many hits.
Oh, what do you mean it's long?
Oh, yeah.
You're as cold as ice.
Yeah.
You're willing to sacrifice our love.
Boom. Boom.
So they
gonna
make it to the top and be a jukebox hero.
Wow.
Boom. It's unbelievable, man.
It's unbelievable. Oh, man. Oh. How many times have you slow danced to this?
This is the number one love song of my adolescence.
Oh,
like,
God.
This defined my romance.
Oh, yeah. This is prom 1988.
Oh, man, driving my dad's company car at night, cranking this thing. What's going on with Kathy? Why doesn't she like me, man? Shit. Oh, are these guys in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
Yes, they are.
They are?
Wow.
All right.
Oh.
This is the one.
This is the one.
You kill me. You kill me. I can't take it anymore, Lou. I can't take it. It's ridiculous.
It's
one
ridiculous.
After the other.
This is unbelievable.
So I'm excited. I'm like, holy shit, fucking Foreigner. So I go back up to the room and I do a quick Google search on the band just to get a, you know, facial recognition of the guys. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's all the young photos of them. So I can't find anything like, you know, I can't find... what's his name? What's the lead singer's name now? Lou Gramm. That's why I can't find Lou Gramm from 2017. So I got a general idea. And then I, you know, take a nap, whatever. I go down. And then I go down to do the show. And I go in the back. And that guy, Doug, you know, he's very professional. And once he shows you what to do, you're out of his hair. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's like, so he's not like babysitting me or anything. So I walk in the back. And there's not really a green room for me. But there's one for Foreigner, so I'm like, I don't know, I bought these guys? I don't even know. And then there's a separate office, production office for Foreigner. So I'm like, yeah, it was nice, leather chairs, coffee, and shit. I'll go in here. So I walk in, and there's two older guys, long hair, and I'm like, it's fucking Lou Gramm. It's Lou Gramm, lead singer of Foreigner. And I walk in, and I go, hey, I'm just the opening comedian. I don't really have a green room. Hope you don't. He's like, no, come on in, sit down. How you doing? I'm like, hey, how you doing, man? Just big fan of the band. Thanks a lot. This is exact words. There's a young girl there. When I say young, she's like in her, you know, 40s, you know, compared to them.
Yeah.
And she's like, hey, you want some coffee, a beer, whatever you want, you know, feel comfortable, hang out. And I was like, yeah, this is exciting. I didn't know you guys were going to be on until about 2 hours ago. And she's like, oh, it'll be a fun show. So I'm like, all right, she must be backup singing now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hanging out with some of the band. They must not want to hang out in the dressing room. So we start talking a little, and she's like, where you from? And I say, Fredonia. And then Lou Graham goes, oh, yeah, Fredonia. That's upstate. I know where that is. I spent 3 nights in jail in Fredonia in 1967. I go, come on. Now I'm telling you, I got pulled over. We had an open container. We were drinking the day before, and they found an open container. And they brought us down, locked us up. And it was a big deal because, you know, we were young, but we were already known, and so it was a big deal. And I'm like, oh, my God, wow, I live right down the block from there. But now I hadn't been on stage since Gotham, which was a few months back. So I'm also like, all right, it's Foreigner. It's my first gig with this guy, Doug. I want things to go well. So I'm a little like, got my notes out. I'm kind of figuring out what I'm going to talk about a little bit. And I'm a little uncomfortable with my set. So I'm not really talking to Lou Graham, giving him my undivided attention, which I feel he deserves because he's a rock legend.
Yeah.
So I look up at him. And I just, a total Hollywood move. I look up at him and I go, I'm sorry. I'm just like half talking here. I'm a little starstruck, which I wasn't. I was just, I mean, so he goes, are you ready for this? He goes, you know, well, the band will be here soon.
What?
I go, the band will be here soon. He goes, yeah. I go, I'll be excited. I start to walk away.
Oh my God.
I just spent 20 minutes talking to a fucking roadie for Foreigner. I thought I was talking to Lou Graham. I'm like, oh, my God, you idiot. Oh, I'm like, was that his polite way of saying, I think you think I'm Lou Graham, and I'm not? Or do you think that up until then, he didn't realize that I thought he was Lou Graham? I couldn't decide. But either way, I was, like, really embarrassed. I'm like, But he's, you know when the roadies do that, Lou, you know that when you ever hear Roadie talk, he's been with Pearl Jam forever. When we started, started out. You're not in the band, guys.
You're not.
Yeah. Oh, it's a team. Yeah. Are you going to stop going to watch Pearl Jam concerts if Kerry and Tim stop working the Roadie crew?
No, I'm going to join the team. Besides, he doesn't look like Lou Graham anymore. He looks like considerably older.
I wouldn't know what he looks like, Lou, because Foreigner is, it's like, it's not the guys.
Yeah, isn't the band like half changed? Like half of the members, not even the members anymore?
There's one.
There's like 17 people in the band, isn't there?
Yes.
Well, yeah, there's a bunch of them. And the lead singer, I can't remember his name, but I bring it up because he was wearing shades on stage. But he used to be in a band called Hurricane, and now he's been fronting Foreigner. And the only one from Foreigner's original band that's part of this was like a guitarist or something. And he didn't make the trip for this one because he was under the weather. Bro, how great would it be when you're in your 70s just be like, I'm not going to go to Vegas, but I'm going to send an Italian kid, 35-year-old, hell of an actor, and he's going to do What's Wrong with People for a month. And then you just sit home and get money from a guy doing you. I mean, that's not Foreigner.
I don't know. There's another band. Wait, so you're saying Foreigner, the lead singer, is not the lead singer anymore?
No, it's no Lou Graham.
Okay.
No Lou Graham. I think Lou Graham's doing other stuff by Lou Graham's self. I don't know what
that's
he's
right.
calling.
Okay, Lou's confirming that. So now, what's the guy that's the lead singer that's like Japanese?
That's Journey.
Okay, that's Journey. So where'd they get that guy? Do you know they got like an Asian guy that sings, I think, better than... Who's the Journey lead singer before that?
Steve Perry.
Steve Perry. So this guy, Journey, I'm thinking... I'm looking at Journey the other night or whatever it was, and I'm like, they got fucking Japanese that they got singing the lead vocals? I've never seen an Asian rock star. Have you?
No, and quite frankly, if Journey was playing with a lead singer that was Asian on my cruise ship, I wouldn't even walk to the front of the boat to see it.
You gotta see this guy, though. It's unbelievable. The guy, Lou, do you know the backstory where they found this guy?
He was a karaoke star in the Philippines. He's Filipino, and he was that good, and they wanted to go on tour again. Steve Perry wasn't doing anything and didn't want to get on stage again, so they said, this kid's good enough, and now he's the lead singer.
But you're not Steve Perry. I'm not seeing Journey. I'm seeing a dude.
I saw him live at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and it sounds note for note, but you're just missing the magic. There's no here he is.
Horrible. It's doing nothing for me. Everybody, don't forget, after the show, we kept the buffet open an extra hour late.
The guy, I'm looking at him, he looks like a beautiful Asian man. Have you seen what this guy looks like? I'm looking at Lou's got him up right now. Long hair. And it looks like it's a... it don't look right.
All right, I don't see him, but let me ask you this question. I can't see him, but if I was a woman, would I rather date that guy or Jeremy Lin?
I think this guy.
Wow.
This guy. Lou, do you have the other original guy?
He must be attractive. I would rather hear Joe Perry be terrible than see this guy be good, because I'm seeing Joe Perry. You understand, man? I don't get that, dude.
Is it?
Oh, that's the real. Oh, yeah. Is that Joe?
Yeah, that's.
That's Joe Perry, right, Lou?
Yeah. Steve Perry.
Yeah.
Steve Perry.
Yeah, Steve Perry. Joe Perry. Yeah, I know Aerosmith. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. No, this guy. Yeah. I got to take it back. This guy's pretty fucking phenomenal. How did they get rid of this guy?
He just decided he didn't want to be on stage. He was there for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He was there. He made a speech. He gave the Filipino kid his blessings and said he was great. And he just wants to do it without him. Or he has a solo album, but he doesn't want to tour. I think maybe his voice is effed up. Like, I don't think he can do it anymore, but nobody knows. That's the secret.
Isn't there a stage fright thing with him, too, maybe?
Yeah, it's something like that. He doesn't want to perform.
Oh. But yeah, I kind of lied a little. I was a little starstruck, but I threw that line in to divert, to kiss Lou Gramm's butt. But it's pretty funny how, like, you can't, sometimes these rock stars, they look completely different by the time they get older, that you don't know who you're talking to anymore.
So did you get to talk to them? Did you get a photo with them? The band?
No, I mean, I listened to one tune and I went to bed. I mean... If I was at a bar and somebody was karaoke-ing Foreigner and they were great, would I go up to that guy when he was done and tell him he was great?
Wait a minute. I stayed and I watched the band when I did that gig. And then I stayed till the end and I got the photo with the band. But you went to bed?
Yeah.
Why? I mean, I don't even like music and I stayed.
But who did you get a photo with, guy?
The whole band.
You keep saying the whole band. Was Lou Gramm there?
I don't know who these fucking guys were. I just know they were the band.
That's my point. Why'd you stay up then? I mean, for what?
Because they were Foreigner.
It was not. That's what I've been telling you for the past 10 minutes. That's what's driving me nuts. Would you stay up to get a photo with the Asian guy? Because he's hitting the high notes in Journey?
Well, it depends. Is the rest of Journey there? I mean, listen, if Vedder is not in Pearl Jam and they got an Asian guy doing Eddie Vedder after the concert, do you think that's Pearl Jam?
Chris Cornell did it with Pearl Jam. It was Chris Cornell and the rest of Pearl Jam as his band, and I still missed Eddie. So, no, if there was an Asian Eddie Vedder, I'm out.
But if you replace the guitarist and say, like Bon Jovi, they don't got Sambora. Is that still Bon Jovi?
Yeah, no, actually, when I went and saw Bon Jovi, I started yelling, "Where's Richie?" You know, for some reason, he makes a difference to me.
Yeah. And by the way, if Chris Cornell was still alive and he was fronting Foreigner, I would have stayed for the whole thing. Because Chris Cornell is Chris Cornell. I don't know Hurricane.
Lou, do we know who's fronting Foreigner? No.
It's half of the band and a replacement singer.
No, it's not half of the band anymore. It's one guy who was like the bassist in the band. And he wasn't even there that day. It's a guy, I can't remember his name. And listen, man, the Hurricane was a good band. I'm not knocking anybody's body of work. I'm just saying it's not the original band. That's all for me.
Can I just say,
yeah,
watching Lou work here, It's really amazing what this man's doing. He's on his chair, off his chair. He's popping over to some weird side computer that he's got. He's looking up shit. I mean, you know, we often think, is Lou there? Is Lou there? But being in the man's presence and seeing how he works, it's quite... I mean, I'm surprised Lou doesn't start charging people just to see what the hell he's doing. And in this room we got to the side, there's like a window. I'm surprised there's not 15 people that paid admission to see this back and forth shit he's doing right now.
Well, I have to listen. I know Lou is impressive, but you don't think he's doing a little tap dance for you?
No, you'd be surprised what a guy can do when he kicks his drinking habit.
Oh yeah, come on! Did you guys see that thing on HBO, The Defiant Ones?
Yeah,
with Jimmy. Yeah, yeah, and Dr. Dre. Sometimes Dre's got his fingers all over those buttons, but it sounds exactly the same. I'm like, he's just tapping. He's going, look at them. They think I'm moving all this shit. I look like an airline pilot. Yeah, Lou, what you doing left and right? What?
He's Grease. Like, he's looking at the intensity. He's looking at the computers.
There's nobody better in the business.
Lou, what are you doing over there? What are you looking for?
I'm trying to find out who exactly still in Foreigner and where Lou Graham is.
That's what I'm saying. It's so obscure, you can't even... Google don't even have it. Google don't even know who Foreigner is.
We're so mad, I've traveled so far to take this naughty life. I wanna know it, love it.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but that fire is so delightful. Since there's no place to go, listen to the Pete and Sebastian Show. Hey, it's your old pal Dean Martin here wishing you all a very Merry Christmas and a happy belated Hanukkah to all my Jewish pals as well. Oh, and Sebastian, good luck getting engaged, my boy. Why don't you do it like I did? Twice. Just get down on one knee, look her in the eye, and say, you want to be one of the lucky ones, baby. Because this handsome Dago is offering you a lifetime with me. If that don't work, offer her the Porsche. Gotta run. It's happy hour, you know.
And I want to say, not to get into flying, just one quick thing. When I was flying home, I had the aisle seat, and there was two young ladies next to me in their mid-20s, maybe late-20s, and they were a lesbian couple. And first of all, I want to throw out there, like, one of them was very affectionate. The other one who was sitting in the middle was really tired, couldn't even keep her eyes open. And the other one was, like, rubbing her back and then rubbing her inner leg and stuff. And I felt like she was daring me to have a problem.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I've reached that age that I'm the old white guy. Like, you can have a problem with us. This is how it is, you know. And, of course, I don't have any problem with you any more than a husband-wife rubbing it up like that, right?
Yeah.
And there's also, and this is just me, I'm not even going to agree, but I tend to find with lesbian couples, I always feel like one of them is way more into being a lesbian than the other one, and she's constantly trying to keep the other one lesbian. Like, don't forget, Carol, we're lesbians. Don't even look at that guy. We're lesbians. I'm gonna go to the bathroom. When I come back, you better still be a lesbian. I felt like she was there. So, but the girl in the middle seat was really tired. This is why I bring it up. And I haven't seen this move in a while. She kept doing this for like an hour and a half, bro. The head bob where she's falling asleep with a hedge, and then it comes violently down and bounces a few times, and her chin hits her chest and it kind of wakes her up, and it just keeps going on and on, and it's not violating my airspace, but a couple times it didn't fall straight, her head fell to the right and kind of got close to me. I'm like, is this broad gonna headbutt me? And then at some point I'm like, why doesn't she switch and take the window seat now? I didn't say anything, and finally the girlfriend had her switch. But do you think you have a right to say to someone, oh, you keep falling asleep and your head keeps bouncing up? Find a different way to sleep.
Oh, man. I don't know. I
I mean, is that in your wheelhouse if she's not hitting you with that? Or
It's not in my airspace. It's not in my airspace. There's no noise involved. There's no stench involved. But it's like a fucking bouncing head.
Yeah, if it's going back that violently where it's startling you, I think you have the right to tap her and go, listen, we're going to have to do something about this.
Right? It's like she died 10 times in a row. Oh, hold on. I got to take this. Hold on one sec.
Yeah.
It's Sadie's. Hey, I'm doing the cast here.
Oh, okay. I just wanted to say hi.
All right. Let me see you. Is she there? Oh, she's not there. Oh, it looks beautiful. All right,
no,
cool.
She's not with me. She's in the back. You need to get here like freaking 6 o'clock.
Okay. Okay.
Kelly Hansen is the lead singer of Foreigner on tour, for anyone who cares.
Kelly
Hansen. Oh, yes. Kelly Hansen from Hurricane. Yeah, bro, my daughter's in a Christmas pageant. It starts tonight. It's a big dance, and they do it again on Saturday in the Opera House. The whole town comes out.
Did you just get scolded to get there by 6 o'clock because there's no parking?
Yeah, it's on Saturday night, and the show starts at 7, and it sells out. We have an opera house in town that holds like 400, 500 seats. It's all decked out. It was built in 1885. It's all decked out. It's right down the block from me. Mom and Dad are coming. It's fucking Norman Rockwell painting. Speaking of Christmas, dude, I saw the photos of your house, that tree, those decorations.
Oh, man, it's all a story.
What's up?
You know, we had the... we had people come over and decorate the tree. We got a tree guy.
You got a tree team. I saw the photo.
Yeah, tree team was in the house. And, you know, and then they come by, they decorate it, and then we come by and we splash our own ornaments on there. But, you know, the tree lighting, that whole thing, I don't want to be bothered with it. Plus, they bring ornaments that I can't even find in the store. So I told these guys, get over here and decorate the damn thing. Beautiful, beautiful tree.
It is a nice tree. I really dig it, though. The balls, though.
The big balls, man. Big ball ornaments. That's the go-to this year. And, you know, I'm sitting there with Lana outside as we're eating our dinner, and they're decorating a tree, and I look and I go, do you feel guilty at all? And fucking people, there's 4 or 5 strangers in our house decorating a tree, and we're out here having a steak. It just don't seem right, you know? Like, I remember the whole fun of Christmas was, first of all, we had to go get the tree. It was up in the attic. So me and my father were arguing up there about, you know, my mother, like, at the bottom of the ladder going, no, the ornaments are in the right corner. That's where they are, marked ornaments. So the whole fun was getting all that shit out. And then our tree was so old, my father had to tie it to the railing because it was leaning. So it was almost like we were roping up a boat that was coming in to dock. We had about 2 ropes on the railing because the tree was leaning to the left.
So, oh, but the memories, man.
But the memories, right? Now I got, you know, 4 starving actresses working on the tree with big balls of ornaments and whatnot. But it's all good. I mean, it looks fantastic, and we're going to go pepper the tree with our own ornaments. But
pepper the tree. So everybody's going to grow up someday going, oh, I remember Christmas. Me and my dad would cut into a filet mignon and go, look at them, untangle the lights. Get it together.
Daddy, when are we going to pepper the tree with our ornament?
So funny, bro, because that's exactly what we did. Like, you know, we were up in the attic, and then Jackie's yelling down, you got the wrong box. Get the other box. And but I did something this year I never did before. I had a tree that needed to come down the backyard. It's only about 50 feet, not that high, but it was a spruce tree. I said to Jack, we're going to cut it down at the end of the summer. I go, let's cut it down during Christmas, and then we'll use the branches and make wreaths and cool shit.
Wow.
Me and Sadie cut that bitch down 2 weekends ago, and then we made a wreath. I'm not even kidding you. It's like bigger than a baby pool. It's giant, maybe about 8 feet around. And I hung that, and then Jackie put all these red lights on it. I tied it with wires, bending the branches, and then we hung that shit on my off of my barn, man. It looks really cool. I gotta send you that.
Oh, it's dedication. You guys are making wreaths out of extra tree.
And when we put up the tree, like Jackie's gonna put the star on, and I'm holding her, and I dropped her, and she fell into the tree. And just the other day, Sadie's like, "Dad, remember when Mommy fell into the tree? That was so funny." So, like, make sure you do a lot of peppering. All right, on this tree, do a lot of peppering.
Yeah, we'll make sure to pepper it up.
Those freaking balls, you people got to hear. He's got Christmas balls on the tree that are like bowling balls.
Oh,
man.
Yeah, no. Bring in reinforcement on the branches so the branch could hold the ball hanging off the damn thing.
With your wife, there will never be a dull moment, man. There will never, you know, with all that, the decor and the decoration, she does it her own way, and you got to love it, man. That's awesome.
Absolutely. So a tree is up. It's very festive at the house. We are feeling very Christmassy. However, and I'm sorry, there is really no place to be during Christmas time than New York City. I mean, it is so Christmassy outside right now. I just thought I would see a reindeer coming down Fifth Avenue. Is this not the Christmassy? This place is so Christmas.
It is. By the way, I just want to do this is a comment from our Christmas show in 2020 when Sebastian goes, "Lou, you guys ready for this? I hired somebody to unwrap the gifts." It's a beautiful time of year there. But are you, you know, that Grove in LA, that surprised me. They do a little, they make it nice.
Oh, no, we went to go see Santa Claus. Here's the thing. We go to the Grove to see Santa Claus. Now, I don't know when you were there, if you had the chance to go see Santa at the Grove.
I saw him, but not with Sadie. She wasn't born yet.
Oh, that's right. That's right. So, for those of you that don't know about Los Angeles, they got this magical place called the Grove. It's an outdoor shopping mall, and they get as many visitors as Disneyland, from what I understand. It's just a... it's just a really cool place to be. So they got, in the middle of this outdoor mall, Santa's house. This thing's got to be about 1,400 square feet. I've never seen anything like this. Normally, growing up, we had Santa sitting in a chair in the mall. You know, it was nothing big. This guy's got his own house. You got to make a reservation in Los Angeles to see Santa Claus. Can you believe it? It's like a restaurant.
Oh, my. A fucking reservation, dude? What is going on?
We go to the thing. It was like noon. I think 11 o'clock noon on a Tuesday. We feel like, nobody's going to be there. And sure enough, the line was very short. We didn't make a reservation. It was just general admission. We got in line. They said it's going to be about 15 minutes long. So we're in line, and then we see another line. And a woman with an iPad. So I said, "Excuse me, what's this?" "Oh, this is reservation only." I go, "People make a reservation to see Santa?" She goes, "Yeah, you get right in. You don't have to wait in the line." So we're getting up to the front of the line. The reservations, of course, are going before us. So we're up next, right? The elves come to the door. There's like three girls who dress like elves. They're like, "We're sorry, Santa has to go to the bathroom, but he'll be right back." And they shut the door. Now, I go to Lana. I go, "Listen, we're getting post-Santa bathroom shut. Like, get me in before the guy goes to the bathroom." Right? I don't know what's...
Listen... When I was a kid, I didn't think Santa shit.
Right?
Santa don't go to the bathroom. What the
So now you got Santa walking through the mall to go to the... Like, listen, I don't want to be in the bathroom at the mall and Santa Claus walk in. Don't you think Santa should have his own, like, outhouse in the house where he just goes so no one sees, like, ruins the illusion? Like, I don't want to be at the... After I go to the bathroom and I go to the sink and Santa's got his gloves off and I'm washing his hands, right?
Absolutely. Bro, I brought it up last week. So all Santa was loitering by the fountain.
Yeah.
You're magical. You don't go to the bathroom at the mall. That's, hold that shit in. Ho, ho, ho.
I'm saying, bro. So we get... We get post-Santa after God knows what he did. Now, we come in with Serafina, and we don't get any ho-ho, like, no ho-ho, none of that. And I'm like, hey, listen, we got to, like, get into the role here. You know, I don't care. Yeah. The kid's 7 months. She don't know what ho-ho-ho is or whatnot. But they have a video package that they offer. You could get a video of your kid going to see Santa. So I'm like, if this thing's on video, give me the ho-ho-ho. Man, what do you want, the little girl? None of that. He's like, hey, how you doing?
How you doing? What am I ordering a sandwich at a deli, guy? I'll have the number two. Hold the egg.
This guy goes with a high. You don't, not even asking her name, nothing. I'm like, hey, guy, I just bought the $70 premium package with the video and the flash drive. You gotta pick it up a notch. I was going to say, we got to do this over again, Santa. Give me a little bit more enthusiasm.
I tell you, you're lucky the kid's on the one, because if she's old enough to remember this shit, I'd really be making you dance.
Yeah,
do you,
no.
Do you wonder if there's a part of that too? If he's like, the kid don't even know what's going on. She's not even one, so I'll just,
I know, you know. I know. That's what I think he was thinking, and I'm sitting there going, man, if this is on video, we really need to spruce it up here. He didn't even ask her, what do you want this year? I know she can't talk, but just like, give me the full Santa experience, especially for $70, for Christ's sake. I got the top package because, you know, they got it's like a car wash over there. They got so many different things you could do. Oh, for $30 you get one phone, for $40 you get two phones, for $50 I just give me the top thing and we'll take it home and we'll look at it. Because my wife's sitting there going, well, if you get the 4 8x10, I go, yeah, get the whole thing and let's go home and tell this Santa to take a cup of coffee. He's falling asleep.
I mean, shit, if we can't get a good Santa in LA, where can you get a good one?
Right?
I mean, this is acting central. Let's go, man.
So I asked one of the elves before we sit down, I go, real beard? She goes, I'm sorry. I go, Santa, has he got a real beard? And she kind of turns red. She goes, don't tell anybody. I told you we have two Santas, and this is the one that doesn't have the real beard.
I'm telling you, she's got the foreigner that I got the other day.
Oh, God. So we put Serafina down on the lap. She was a sweetheart. She didn't cry, no nothing. We got, you know, a half a smile out of her. And then when we got out of the mall, and then I went over to pick up some steaks. And then later on that night, they came over with the decor for the for the tree. So we're all ready. We're all set. I know you sent me a text on the Christmas gifts that are coming to the house.
Yeah.
And there's like rules. You could open one, you can't open this one, you gotta open that one together, that whole thing. Let me preface by saying I don't think anybody's getting gifts from me until after January. I have no time to do a damn thing. So nobody's getting gifts except for my immediate family. So don't expect anything.
That's right. Hold on. You know, text Jack, tell him to shut down on delivery. then neither are you, guy. Holy shit. I'm only kidding.
Oh, my God.
I'm getting... Oh, by the way, I meant to tell you guys. Remember when I showed you that photo of me and Leah Remini?
Oh, yeah.
2 days ago, we're in the writer's room. She comes in, and she's saying something about the way she used to look in King of Queens. And I go, hey, listen, man, my wife showed a photo of us, and she told me that you look beautiful. And she goes, oh, well, that's very sweet of your wife, but I touched up the photo. Because Leah took the photo on her phone.
Oh, yeah.
So I go, what do you mean you touched it up? And she goes, there's an app where you can touch up the phone and make, you know, airbrush it. So I go, oh, wow, well, you look great. And then she goes, oh, my God, you don't think I airbrushed you, too? You really think you're that good looking?
Oh, she did you too?
Yeah, she did me too. And then she's making fun of me because I go, well, you look good. And she goes, oh, you don't think I airbrushed you? Oh, my God. I airbrushed you too, dummy. That's what she said. And I go, oh, shit.
Oh, wow. I didn't realize. She did. I'm looking at it right now. She did give you some makeup.
Yeah. And then she took a photo of someone in the room and showed us how it works, how you can. So she goes, yeah, I do this with all my photos. So, but it was funny because she's making fun of me because she goes, I can't believe you thought that. That's how you. I go, I really did think I was looking good.
Wow.
So that's, bro, I got to show you that app. Look at my face. I look, hey.
Who can see your face? It's going through so many filters.
Let me plug first before we get into Coliseums and shit. First of all, January 5th and 6th, you're looking for something to do right after the holiday, guys. I'll be at Bananas in Hasbrook Heights, New Jersey, 2 Friday, 2 Saturday. Big show February 20th. I'm part of the Patrice O'Neill benefit. Billy Burr is basically the anchor comic who puts it together every year. Rich Voss hosts, and the hilarious Robert Kelly. And so that's February 20th. You can just Google Patrice O'Neill benefit. It's in New York City. And that's it. Other than go to my Facebook, I've been posting my Tony P. Christmas clips from that movie, so check them out. And I know they're stupid and ridiculous, guys, so you can rip on them. It's not like I don't think they are. And lastly, Sebastian, can we get a mailbag going again? I'm missing
No, we'll get the mailbag going for sure. It's just I haven't had time to check my own mail, let alone the Pete Sebastian show mail, but we'll get that for the fans because I know they like it, and I have a lot to go through. Let's go. January 13th, I'll be in Windsor, Ontario at the Coliseum at Caesars Windsor. Rochester on January 25th. Syracuse, January 27th. Concord, New Hampshire, February 8th. February 9th, I'll be in Providence, Rhode Island. February 10th, I will be at the MGM National Harbor in Oxon Hill, Maryland. February 16th at Napa Uptown Theater. SebastianLive.com. Get your tickets. And we got one more show. We'll close the year out. We're taking a week off, and then we'll fire it right back up. This has been a pleasure to watch the maestro himself. And I'm not talking about Pacelli. I'm talking about Lou. On the ones and twos back here. Always a pleasure. Please spread the Pete and Sebastian show to your friends and family. What a pleasure it is to be working with you guys.
Same.
These little town blues are melting away.
Up to you, New York, New York, New York, New York. Yeah.
The show has ended.
Keep saying the whole band. Was Lou Graham there?
I don't know who these fucking guys were. I just know they were the band.
That's my point. Why'd you stay up then? I mean, for what?
Because there were four. Lead singer.
It was not. That's what I've been telling you for the past 10 minutes. That's what's driving me nuts. Would you stay up to get a photo with the Asian guy? Because he's hitting the high notes in Journey?